Right. The next talk is by one of our Simons Berkeley postdoctoral fellows, William Hoza, who will tell us about pseudorandom generators and small space de-randomization.
Thanks. So I'm William. Hi, everybody. This is my second year as a postdoc here. I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about pseudorandomness. A pseudorandom generator is a function that stretches a short truly random seed out to a long pseudorandom string. And what we mean by that is that for every Boolean function f in some class script f, the acceptance probability of f is approximately the same whether you plug in truly random bits or you plug in pseudorandom bits that you get from the generator. Okay. Now, traditionally, the class script f that people have been most interested in maybe is where you take script f to be like everything that can be computed in polynomial time, right? Pseudorandom generators that fool all polynomial time computations and that can themselves be computed in polynomial time are important and useful for cryptography and de-randomization and all sorts of other things. But the only trouble with such pseudorandom generators is that we don't know whether they exist. Right. It seems to be extremely difficult to design pseudorandom generators that fool all polynomial time computations. And so for the time being, we should probably consider them to be out of reach. And so what I think is more interesting is to consider a class script F that's like a much more restricted model of computation. Okay, a weaker model, because that way we can actually prove something. We can actually design pseudorandom generators that work. So here's like a toy example that hopefully can clarify the idea. We could take script F to be the class of all depth two decision trees. Okay. Here's a pseudorandom generator that stretches 2 bits to 3 bits and fools this model. The generator is right there. G of x, y is x, and then y, and then the xor of x and y, right? So these 3 bits, x, y, and the xor, that's like the traditional example of three random variables that are pairwise independent, but not mutually independent, right? And so because they're pairwise independent, they fool any depth two decision tree, a decision tree that looks at just 2 bits. Okay, so hopefully that like clarifies the paradigm, but of course, really we would like to fool richer and more interesting models of computation than just this like depth two decision trees on 3 input bits. So to give you a few examples of my own research with collaborators, you know, I've designed pseudorandom generators that fool, I think, interesting models of computation, things like bounded depth threshold circuits or like bounded depth read once formulas or certain types of branching programs. I want to emphasize that in every case, like these pseudorandom generators are unconditional. We don't rely on any unproven mathematical assumptions. So going forward, yeah, sure. Yes, that's right. So going forward, some of the remaining challenges for pseudorandom generator designers are to design better pseudorandom generators that fool space-bounded computation, and to design better pseudorandom generators that fool various types of bounded depth circuits. I should probably say something about what's the point of all this? I guess the most basic reason to design pseudorandom generators is because we want to think of random bits as like a computational resource, kind of like time or space. Okay, so just like a faster algorithm is better than a slower algorithm, similarly, an algorithm that uses less randomness is better than an algorithm that uses more randomness, right? And best of all is a completely deterministic algorithm, an algorithm that uses zero random bits, right? And pseudorandom generators can be useful for designing deterministic algorithms too, because basically the trick is that you can exhaustively try all seeds to the pseudorandom generator. Ironically, pseudorandom generators also sometimes have applications to the design of randomized algorithms. And lastly, probably the most important application of pseudorandom generators is that every time we design a pseudorandom generator that fools some model of computation, F, That teaches us, you know, something about that model F. It gives us insights into the limits and abilities of that model F, because a pseudorandom generator is basically like a particularly high quality type of lower bound. Okay, it's giving an example of some task, something that this model of computation like cannot understand at all. Okay, actually, I want to go back to this the second point here, this topic of de-randomizing algorithms. This has been like a traditional goal in complexity theory for a long time, right? We would like to understand the role of randomness in computation. We would like to take randomized algorithms and convert them into deterministic algorithms, while being, you know, while retaining efficiency by other measures such as space complexity. Okay, so some terminology. BP space S is the class of all languages that can be decided by randomized algorithms using O of S bits of space. Okay. The commonly believed conjecture in complexity theory is that BP space S coincides with deterministic space S. Okay, so this conjecture is saying that randomness is not actually necessary for space efficient computation, so you can feel free to throw all your fair coins into the trash can. I think this is a really nice conjecture, a really nice problem. I think, first of all, it's like it's appealing in sort of a, you know, quasi-philosophical way, much like other topics in complexity theory, like the P versus NP problem, right? It seems to be like saying something very fundamental about the power of randomness, about these resources. But another thing that I find appealing about this problem that maybe sets it apart from like P versus NP is that there has actually been quite a lot of successful progress on this problem. We have a lot of theorems that say, you know, some kind of interesting de-randomization of space-bounded computation, even if they don't, you know, fully prove this conjecture. So just to give you a couple of examples from my own research, today, like the state-of-the-art de-randomization of BP space S says that, you know, if you have a randomized algorithm that uses S bits of space, then we can simulate it deterministically using O of S to the 3/2 over square root log S bits of space. Okay. And this is like, you know, just barely better than, you know, what was proven back in the 90s, but maybe the main point is that it's you know, we have some bound, right? It's something that's non-trivial. We actually can prove some type of unconditional de-randomization. Another example from my own work is that suppose you can design some randomized algorithm that simultaneously uses a small amount of space and a small amount of time. Okay, maybe it's like log space, quasi-linear time. Then we can get a deterministic algorithm for that problem that still runs in logarithmic space, with the caveat that occasionally it gives the wrong answer. It might give the wrong answer on some small fraction of inputs of each length. So to try to give you like a taste of the techniques that go into you know, these works, like how do you get started proving some kind of de-randomization, let me tell you like some of the ideas behind this second theorem. So the first idea goes back to work by Goldreich and Vigerson, which is if we're willing to settle for a typically correct de-randomization, we're okay with getting a wrong answer on a few inputs, then we can think of the input as being selected at random and we're trying to succeed with high probability. Right. And if the input is selected at random, then great. That right there is like a source of random bits that we can try to use to simulate this randomized algorithm. Now, the difficulty with you know, making that work is that, well, I mean, when a randomized algorithm is designed, we assume that the input and the random bits are independent. Right. And so if we try to use the input as a source of random bits, then we're introducing some troublesome correlations. And the approach for breaking those correlations was basically to use part of the input as a source of random bits while the algorithm is looking somewhere else, with the intuition being like, this way, the stuff that we're feeding in as random bits to the algorithm is more or less independent of everything that the algorithm is currently thinking about. And of course, some additional ideas are necessary to make this approach make any sense, but it turns out that it can be made to work.
I have a question.
Yeah.
This type of idea is in the context of weights, and the inputs are random anyway. In some sense, you're choosing random subsets of the train, and in the same way,
that's a good question.
Something about
Corman. Can you repeat the question?
Yeah. So the question was whether this sort of like using the input as a source of random bits Does that idea have applications in like machine learning types of settings where, you know, we're thinking of the input as being selected from some distribution anyway? I mean, it's standard in machine learning that we're okay with getting the wrong answer occasionally. Yeah, that's a great question. I'm not aware of any work that does that type of thing. You know, there are, you know, quite a few. You know, Ulrich and Vigerson's work was spawned quite a lot of follow up. But all the work that I'm aware of is more like in a complexity theoretic setting. But that's a good question. I don't know. Okay. So anyway, I just wanted to say really quickly, like, all right, so that was an example of like a partial de-randomization of space-bounded computation. But I want to emphasize that like there are no barriers known. There's no particular reason, you know, there's nothing known that's stopping us from proving a full de-randomization of space-bounded computation. So, you know, I'd love to chat with you about it if you're interested in working on this problem with me, or, you know, maybe some easier problems along the way. Okay, and just really quickly, I should say, like, besides like pseudorandomness and de-randomization, more generally what I'm interested in is like complexity theory. So for example, some of my recent work is about like circuit lower bounds. So that's other stuff that you could talk to me if you want. So thanks for listening.
So there's this work on side channel attacks, you know, which was in the pseudorandom number generation. So suppose part of your seed leaks.
Yeah.
And then can you still say something about the outcome? So is that a little bit related? Because you're saying the Goldreich, the Vigerson work, they are using one part.
Yeah. It is absolutely related.
Oh, it is.
Yeah. So it turns out, so this isn't what Goldreich and Vigerson did, yeah. But there were some of the follow-up work was showing that if you have like a pseudorandom generator with this like seed extending property, mm-hmm. so like the first thing that the generator outputs is the seed, and then it outputs a bunch of other stuff, mm-hmm. then those pseudorandom generators can imply typically correct de-randomizations. And it's for like the sort of reasons that you're saying, like we want pseudorandomness that's still pseudorandom, even if you know the seed.
Well, part of it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for the great talk. I really enjoyed it. I had a very quick question. So you said that the definition of the pseudorandoms is that the probabilities of it actually being uniform and probability being output by the algorithm are essentially the same. What does it mean to be sort of how close do they have to be? Does that make sense?
I just put some approximately equals sign, right? Yeah. So I mean, in general, you know, we care about the error parameter epsilon. Okay. And so I guess for like this space-bounded de-randomization problem, for, you know, general like complexity theoretic de-randomization, it's really fine if the error is just some small constant, like let's say 0.1. Because, you know, if we're trying to de-randomize some randomized algorithm, we could first improve the randomized algorithm to have a low error probability, right? And if it has a low error probability, then when you use a pseudorandom generator instead of true random bits, that low error probability just, you know, it increases by maybe 1% or whatever. But there are other contexts where it matters about, you know, getting a very small error for a pseudorandom generator. And so that's absolutely like, you know, part of what we care about in this research.
Okay, maybe we'll have the next speaker set up if there's one more quick question. Okay. Thanks, William.